Hey, San Diego, welcome to Homefront. I'm your host, Eve Nasby. We have a great show planned for you today. One of our guests is Marjorie Morrison from PsychArmor, an incredible organization that helps folks understand PTSD. We also have a legend here in San Diego, John Engstrom. He's a Marine Mustang. He's doing SBA, Boots to Business, Business 101. You're not going to want to miss John's segment. And AJ, you've got some guests coming on too.
We have some fantastic guests here. We have the patron saint of the San Diego film community, Jodi, Cilley. We also have one of the best filmmakers in San Diego, very talented, Sara Vladic, with us here on Homefront.
I say we get the show started, AJ.
Let's get started.
Woohoo! Welcome back to Homefront. I'm your host, Eve Nasby, and you are about to witness the Homefront Hero segment with one of my most favorite people in San Diego, Marjorie Morrison. Marjorie, welcome to the show.
Hi, Eve. Thanks for having me. You're one of my most favorite people, just like marveling at how much you have grown in the time from I first met you at radio.
I know,
and
right?
Now you're just exploding.
We're having fun here, and we love to highlight great companies that are doing great things. And you started PsychArmor a few years ago. Talk about that.
Yeah, it's hard for me to believe it's only been 2.5 years.
But it
came out of, I was a clinician, mental health care provider in San Diego, and I knew nothing about the military. And you can't live in San Diego and not see veterans and service members in your practice. And I didn't know anything. I didn't know I needed to know anything. And then I got an opportunity to work on base at MCRD, and I got this great opportunity to spend a year there and get to know all the drill instructors. And I had to work so hard to find military culture, to learn, because you kind of have to understand them. You know, we have 1% of our country serving.
Yes.
And so about 10% connected. So 90% of us, like myself, like didn't know anything. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't find information fast enough.
To help those that were coming into your practice that were in the military.
Right, well, to help me, to help give me the tools to help people.
Got it.
So that I could talk the lingo and understand the uniqueness of the issues that they had. So I had this idea of starting an organization. I didn't really want to start a nonprofit, but I ended up starting one. But I had this idea, why can't we have a central depository where people could go if they want to learn about veterans? Mm-hmm. You see a homeless veteran on the street, what can you do? How can you help them? Or
right.
You want to volunteer, or you want to hire them. How could civilians like us learn how to support them? And so I had this idea, and I had an amazing funder who gave us $1 million seed grant to build it. And we started out building online courses. We now to date have over 130 online courses.
Oh my goodness.
We've had over 200,000 learners. All of our courses are free. We've had about 92% of our learners come back for our second class. Our courses are all categorized into different sections. So we have a number of courses for healthcare providers. We have a number of courses for employers, mm-hmm. caregivers and family members, volunteers, educators. We train teachers. So it's pretty cool.
So let's bring this down to reality. I've got a friend who's struggling, and I don't know how to help this person. My next step is to go onto your website, and I can find classes that'll educate me on how to help them.
That's exactly right. And the way we designed it, too, is it's not like you have to go take 2 days worth of courses. Really, it's if you think about it, it's like a public library. But instead of brick and mortar, it's virtual, it's 24/7. Mm-hmm. And instead of books, you're looking at online videos. So now, if your friend is struggling with addiction issues, we have a course for you. Mm-hmm. If your friend is struggling with maybe some depression, or it could be PTSD or whatever it could be, there's a whole variety of things that we have our different courses for. We have how to have suicide, how to do a suicide assessment, how to help someone get help, how to do things from a trauma-informed perspective.
And I can see too this transition into the employment world, where you've got people in human resources who are just not trained in this, and so they too then can jump on and watch one of these videos and get a deeper understanding of how to help their employees.
Yeah, it's true. You know, One of the problems right now is veterans carry this narrative that they all have PTSD. Mm. And it came from an earlier movement where we were trying to get service members to step up mm-hmm. and seek help. Mm-hmm. And we hurt them. I mean, and I think I was part of that. But, you know, now we look at that actually has been really detrimental. And because of it, now employers just assume veterans have PTSD.
Yes.
So a lot of our education and our courses are around dispelling that myth, showing them the truth, which is, you know, civilians also have PTSD.
Right.
It isn't something unique right. just to veterans, and that, you know, veterans are not violent. And in fact, people that do have PTSD tend to be more withdrawn and avoid situations. Mm-hmm. They're not violent and unpredictable like we oftentimes are told that they are. So a lot of our educator courses are around really understanding the assets and the values that veterans bring to the workplace, helping them decode resumes, helping them interview them effectively, mm-hmm. helping onboard them and retaining them in the companies.
And I think also, too, accommodating them. When you have someone with a disability, when you have someone with PTSD, that's okay. How do you accommodate them in the workplace? You could change the lighting, put them in a place where they've got an open window. Those types of things are practical things that you can do, and that's what you teach.
That's right, yes.
And I love it.
Yeah.
What have you got coming up in the future?
Wow. So, you know, we started out with healthcare and employer. We kept moving and we thought, okay, we've hit critical mass. But we're a staff of almost 40 and we've got over 20 developers. And
okay. In 2.5 years,
yes.
You've gone from 0 to 40 employees.
Yes.
Marjorie,
and amazing
that's
employees. And you know what? We have a clinical team and we have a development team. So we're really, I think, the only ones that I know of out there that build online education with a healthcare slant to it, with a clinical lens. So, yes, things have gotten a little bit busy for us. So now we're building a whole bunch of new courses for faith leaders, chaplains and priests and rabbis, because community and also, you know, I'm based in the veteran, these chaplains and these faith leaders are often gatekeepers for mm-hmm. issues. They're often the times the first place people go and nobody's helping them, mm-hmm. giving them the tools of how to, you know, work effectively with veterans. So we have a bunch of courses coming for that. We're working with legal professionals. We have a whole slew of courses for lawyers and paralegals and legal aid, financial counselors, another group of people. When people are struggling, oftentimes money comes into play and financial difficulties can put anybody in a bad situation. So we're arming financial counselors with a lot of tools, early warning signs, how to be supportive, you know, how to recognize and get people to get help. We have some courses for first responders. And then one of the ones we're really excited about is our new school and series of courses for public servants. So we're working with 8 cities across the country and their mayor's offices that have more vibrant veteran leads. So we have New York, DC, Chicago, LA, Houston. I'm drawing a blank.
But tell us how we can get involved with what you're doing, because obviously prevention goes a long way, right? And so if we know somebody that's struggling or if we just want to get educated, where do we go to get the link to what you're doing?
Yeah, so thank you for that. PsychArmor.org, PsychArmor.org. You go on there, everything is free. There's no trickery. We never ask anybody for money. Our courses are all sponsored. And I just, you know, I can't encourage people enough to learn because.
Awesome. Marjorie, you are amazing. Thank you so much for all that you're doing. And again, thank you for being a part of Homefront.
Thanks for having me.
We will be right back with more of Homefront. Don't go away.
With career coaching and employment workshops, Hire Heroes USA empowers military members, veterans, and spouses in their job search at no cost to them. Go to hireheroesusa.org to learn how you can support our mission.
Welcome back to Homefront. I'm Eve Nasby, and we are in our finance segment, and we've got with us a San Diego legend, John Engstrom. John, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Eve. Pleasure to be here with you.
You do so much, and you have done so much, and I want to jump right into this by talking about your incredible military career, because not very many people follow the path that you followed. So talk about that.
Sure. Roughly less than 1% can accomplish what I've done. I came in, enlisted in the Marine Corps, came up through the enlisted ranks. I was appointed a warrant officer based on my technical expertise, strong leadership and managerial ability. And then I moved into the officer ranks as a limited duty officer to perform a more strategic role, and I retired as a major.
Wow.
And I did 25 years.
And you're called a Mustang.
Yes.
Because you're both enlisted in the officer ranks.
Correct.
Which makes you so approachable to all of the different levels of the branch of the military and the people that are in there.
Yeah, right? Absolutely. I know what it's like to be a young Marine and not getting paid, or when I was a corporal, I was getting paid $414.40 a month. I know what that's like.
Wow. And now you are working with the SBA, which is a very nice transition, because talk about what you're doing, because you know how to put the cookies on the bottom shelf so that people like me can understand how to navigate becoming our own business owners and things like that. So talk about that, what you're doing for our veterans.
Sure. We have we do have some veterans in the program. I manage the 8A program, and it's a program that it's a 9-year program where we focus on getting government contracts. And we're doing so well that the first quarter of this year, we've had $132 million of contracts being awarded to our firms. And we have 110 of these firms, small businesses in San Diego.
Well, I don't think many people realize that the veteran business owners in America generate $1 trillion in revenues. And so there's a lot of opportunity for veterans to become their own business owners. But it's not an easy process. So talk about what the SBA can do to help these veterans who are thinking, maybe I want to start my own business. I really want to know what that looks like. How do you walk them step by step through that?
Sure. The best advice I could give them is to seek out SCORE. SCORE is basically a service corps of retired executives, mm-hmm. people that have been there and done that. They have a wealth of knowledge, and they can get them started. They can answer all the questions. Okay. They could help them with all the paperwork. And if they get in the 8A program, then I can help.
Right. And you guys have counseled over 100,000 veterans on an annual basis in becoming their own businesses.
Sure.
That's just an incredible statistic.
Yeah, and the neat thing about small businesses and the federal government, if you had a pie, whatever your favorite pie is, 23% of that pie is set aside for small businesses. Mm. So what that means in the year of 2016, $471.7 billion in contract money went to small businesses.
Wow.
And 8A clients can have up to 5% of that. Women-owned small business could have up to 5% of that. Veterans can have 3% of it. And hub zone owners could have up to 3%.
That's a lot of money.
Yes.
That's fantastic. And do you help us find funding? Is that part of your program as well?
Well, we have a lender list. So I can never recommend a lender to anyone, but I could give them a lender list and they can take a look at all the SBA approved lenders and pick the one that's best for them.
And now you're known for wearing multiple hats, so you're also one of the pioneers of Business 101. So talk about what that program is and who it serves.
Sure. There's a team of four of us, and we volunteer our time to do this. And when I transitioned from the Marine Corps, my transition was easy. Mm. I had my job before I made my transition, and there's a lot of veterans now that are having difficulty doing that.
Yes.
So with Business 101, this is a way that I can give something back to my fellow veterans. We can help make their transition smoother. It's a 4-day class. Our next class is coming up from May 8th through the 11th at Camp Pendleton. Mm-hmm. And basically what I teach a segment, Let's Get Hired Soon. I teach a course on LinkedIn. And then I moderate two panels, a veterans panel and an employer panel, where I actually bring employers into the classroom that hire veterans.
Wow. How many people are typically in your class, and who is eligible to be in that class?
Okay, great question. Usually we have between 60 to 80 personnel. A lot of them, we get more signups, but then they get deployed or they're sent away for a little while. And the course curriculum is designed for officers and senior enlisted. So in the Marine Corps, Staff Sergeant above, Navy would be First Class Petty Officer and above. But as a Mustang, if I have a Sergeant or a Second Class Petty Officer that has a 4-year degree, I will bring them in.
Now, as part of your program, I'm sure you've seen mistakes. What's the typical mistake that somebody that's transitioning out makes?
There are some people that feel that they're entitled to get a job, and that's on one spectrum. The other spectrum is no matter what branch of service a veteran has served in, they have done some amazing things, mm-hmm. but they just can't put that down on paper. They're a little too humble. So if you're a veteran and you're looking for an employment opportunity, put your stuff down on paper, mm-hmm. your accomplishments. Use numbers. Numbers jump off of a page. And one of the wisest things I heard, I was on a panel with someone else, and he says, I take a resume, and I turn it upside down, and I circle all the numbers, and then I turn it over. If you have no numbers on your page, that shows you have no accomplishments.
Wow. So these and many more tips we can learn in your four-day course, Business 101 at Camp Pendleton. How can we get signed up for that?
Well, a matter of fact, I would encourage all veterans that are listening in, that are not LinkedIn with me yet, to join me on LinkedIn,
okay.
John Engstrom. There's over 80 John Engstroms on LinkedIn. I have over 27,000 first degree connections. I'll be at the top of the list. Send me an invite to join me on LinkedIn. And on my profile under Business 101, you'll see the registration link.
Perfect. John,
we'd love to have you in our class.
John, you're amazing. So from SBA to Business 101, you've done it all, and you still run, I don't even know, 13 miles uphill in the sand every day. So thank you for being a part of our show.
Thank you, Eve. Always a pleasure.
We will be right back with more of Homefront. Don't go away.
Welcome back to Homefront. I'm your host, AJ Brooks. In the studio, we have two folks from the GI Film Festival, SD.org. From the Film Consortium, we have Jodi Cilley.
Thanks for having
and
me.
And Sara Vladic. Sara, you brought one of your awards, and you got a bunch of these last year at the GI Film Festival.
We did. It was a very successful event for us, and a lot of great things came from it.
So this thing weighs how much?
25 pounds, at least.
But it took you 16 years to make.
It did.
And it's a story 70 years in the making.
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about the USS Indianapolis. I know there's a scene in Jaws when they're talking about the men floating around on the water. That's actually these men. This is real. That wasn't just for theater.
That's actually, I mean, the Jaws story kind of drove part of it. The documentary was what, you know, inspired my interest in it. But the story really is about the ship that carried the atomic bomb. It was sunk. These men were left at sea for 5 days. And then, you know, without the Navy, without anyone knowing they were missing, and then only out of 1,197 that went in the water, 317 lived.
So on average, people die after 3 days without food and water. Mm-hmm. These guys were adrift at sea in direct sunlight. Some of them actually were bitten by sharks,
yes.
and survived.
Mm-hmm.
They were so dehydrated that it was the rescuers that had to sort of recreate the story.
Very much so. You know, the rescuers really tell the end of the story. The guys tell how they got in the water, but it's the rescuers that told about their condition, the mindset they were in, you know, how they rescued them was actually a miracle in and of itself. So it was an incredible story to hear, finally, from people who had the awareness at the time and, you know, were healthy enough to actually convey what took place in the waters.
You know, Jodi, you have been a part of so many different stories that have been told here in San Diego.
Yeah.
And I know I like to call you the patron saint of the San Diego film community. You care about policy, setting conditions to tell stories, and to bring more film and film attention to San Diego. This is a fantastic story, but it's really about a ship in the Pacific. But it's really, really about the men that served on that ship. And you built relationships with them over years before you got to this point.
Very much so. I think that was part of why they chose me to tell their story and why they actually opened up. Is, you know, I've spent 4 years with them before we ever started going on camera. So it was really, these men have become like grandparents to me. And it's been quite an honor to get to tell their story.
Now, there were no women stationed aboard the USS Indianapolis,
right.
but you were made an honorary member of the crew, so to speak. Is that right?
Yeah. Last year, they made me an honorary survivor. And so I got a badge and everything. It's pretty cool. So it's more than an honor to have that, you know, as something I earned as part of this.
This is the Homefront family segment. And one of the things about filmmaking in general and storytelling is creating connection. And I know that just a couple weeks ago, we had the San Diego Film Awards. And there were so many local stories told, but there were so many local filmmakers telling global stories like this. Mm-hmm. I know you've worked on other projects, and there's an opportunity for people in the community that want to tell stories mm-hmm. to submit. Isn't that right?
Yes, coming up May 15th is the deadline, and it's the GI Film Festival San Diego, and I can't encourage people enough to participate in it. If they don't have a film ready, go to it. Meet people, network, find crew members. You know, Jodi can talk about this too. It's really a great community to be part of, and it's, you know, this festival is something that brings it to the attention of the, you know, the rest of San Diego.
You know, Jodi, I've seen films that have been shot entirely on a cell phone.
This happens.
We have film festivals dedicated just to smartphones and small devices and short films.
One in San Diego, yeah.
You don't have to have financing or a cool box or a neat logo or 16 years of relationships to tell a story and create connection and build community.
No, and in the case of the GI Film Festival, we're here in San Diego with this incredible military population and all these great stories. And a lot of people just stay here after the military. Why would you not? It's a beautiful place.
Right.
And it creates this vibrant place for military, but also this vibrant film community. And I think the GI Film Festival really kind of brings that out. It allows us to highlight and showcase stories from and by and about military in San Diego. And, you know, GI Film Festival isn't just about, you know, military stories. You know,
right.
We're not just watching, you know, great documentaries like the USS Indianapolis.
There were some great love stories last
year.
Exactly. Some fun stories, some short stories.
Are about all sorts of things. And I think it's really giving the opportunity to veterans and active duty military to participate in any kind of storytelling that they want, mm-hmm. not just, you know, tell the stories, although that as well is a very important piece of it.
So I saw several films last year. I tried to attend as many as I could. We actually got to present on a panel.
Yeah.
We had so many great venues. You told stories in Coronado. You screened films there. You screened them in Balboa Park.
Yeah.
And then you also screened them at the Hazard Center, right?
Yeah. And this year, they're still working out the finalized locations, but we're at the Museum of Photographic Arts, as well as on the Midway.
That's an amazing venue.
It's an amazing place to be able to watch a film.
One of the neatest things for me was just being able to bounce around town and see places I'd never watched a movie before.
Yeah, Coronado was one of those, I'm curious what this beautiful venue, you know it'd be
from
great,
the street,
but that was phenomenal.
It was phenomenal. From the street, it looks like a
phenomenal.
Tiny theater. It's an amazing venue.
Yeah.
It was a great opportunity to do that. So I'm sitting here watching Homefront on a Saturday morning, and I'm thinking, I have a story to tell, but I don't have a connection to the military, but I do have a smartphone, and I've always wanted to tell a story about this. Do they qualify as a local filmmaker?
Yeah, anyone who's here in San Diego or Imperial County actually qualifies for the GI Film Festival San Diego. Now, in the case of something like documentaries, you know, those topics are in some cases, especially, you know, national or international, they're not necessarily just made here in San Diego. But so we have criteria such as, you know, being from San Diego, being about the San Diego military community, having a certain, you know, percentage of people that are in it who helped produce it or whatever, who have a certain, you know, connection to San Diego. So it's pretty broad, actually. There's a lot of different ways you can fit into it, but I think it's important to note, you know, the deadline's coming up May 15th. We are looking for stories from military. It doesn't have to be, you know, just about the military, but also for stories about the robust and beautiful community that we have here of veterans and active duty.
So the GI Film Festival was actually started in D.C., and the GI Film Festival, sd.org, is where you can go to learn more about it. But this is an opportunity to tell those stories here in America's finest city. Mm-hmm. Sara, thank you for being in the studio. You're a friend of the show. Jodi, welcome back. Thank you for being here again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was Jodi Cilley from the Film Consortium and Sara Vladic on behalf of GI Film Festival, sd.org.
Hey, welcome back to the Homefront. I'm Daniel Lehman. I am the host of your home ownership segment. On the Homefront, we believe that if you've served your country, you deserve to own a piece of it. I serve as the Vice President of Mortgage Lending for Synergy One Lending and the Director of VA Lending for Veterans One Lending. And so we've got your Veteran Home of the Week. With me to profile the Home of the Week is my good buddy Jacob Yeagle with Big Block.
Hey, how's it going, Dan?
How are you, my friend?
Doing well.
So, first we should say you're a Marine Corps veteran.
Yes, sir.
So you served, what, 4 years, 5 years?
No, I did 9 years, Dan.
9 years, so I knocked it down a peg, man. Sorry.
Yeah, two enlistments, all at Miramar.
So what got you into real estate after getting out of the Marine Corps?
Well, I just wanted to find a way to better serve the veterans and active duty military in San Diego. I've found great success in it, just networking with people that I knew in the Marine Corps and outside the Marine Corps.
Let's be honest, man. There's some good agents and some bad agents out there, and especially when you throw in, like, kind of the complexities of the veteran. Not just the VA loan, because people talk about the complexity of the VA loan, but forget that, the veteran. How do you serve the veteran best, and what better to serve a veteran than a veteran, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we do see a lot of people getting out of the military and then just going straight into real estate, and a lot of them haven't, you know, taken the necessary steps to learn the VA loan process, and that's... It is a complex process.
Yeah, or you got people that are going to agents that do all types of other kind of business and they don't really understand VA, or they steer them away from VA. But hey, man, so you've got the Home of the Week this week. It's 535 West Fig, right?
Yes, sir.
So tell us about it, man.
So it's actually a property that has two separate properties on it. One is a two-bedroom two-bath detached home, and then another part of the home is it has a granny flat that's also detached from the home, which is a one-bed, one-bath. Great opportunity to rent out. It's right outside the back gate of Camp Pendleton.
It's actually owned by a Marine now, right?
Yes, it's owned by a Marine Massenet right now.
And
He's actually rented out that separate granny flat for $800 a month.
Very cool, man. So 535 West Fig in Fallbrook, right outside the back gate. Listed at, what, 470?
Yes, sir.
So San Diego County, the loan limit in San Diego County is 612-950. So as a Marine, as a military member or a veteran, you can buy this home with zero down, right?
Yes.
No money down. You could actually structure the file where the seller pays your closing costs or the lender pays your closing costs. And if you look at like kind of current market rate, you're looking at like just over $2,750 bucks a month. You throw in $800 bucks in rent. I mean, you can have this thing right now.
Yeah, for under your BAH.
So you can basically have zero down, make no payment for closing costs if you structure it the right way. And you can have a payment that's right around the BAH.
Absolutely, even
level.
Less than BAH.
You're less than BAH.
Still pocketing some.
It's one APN though, right? It's one lot.
Yes.
So you wouldn't be able to use the rent to qualify, but you could certainly rent it out and make some of that money back and net out at under $2,000 a month.
True.
That's ridiculous.
Very true.
Very cool. So 535 West Fig, check it out. If you want more information on this particular property, homefrontmedia.org/homeownership, and we'll have Fig on there. Jacob, how can they get a hold of you, man?
Cell phone is the best method, 619-723-9284.
And again, at the Homefront, we believe that if you serve your country, you deserve to own a piece of it. So go take a look at Fig, or give us a call if you got anything else that you need, or you want to get pre-qualified, or look at some property. Kind of low inventory right now.
Yeah, but it's a little crazy out there, but there is stuff available.
So get your plan together and let's drive some more veteran homeownership. Thanks so much for coming in, man.
Thanks for having me, Dan.
All right, we'll be right back with more from the Homefront.
Hey, welcome back to Homefront. Well, AJ, we had another amazing show.
We did have a great show.
We have some phenomenal guests.
We
sure did. San Diego is full of talented people, and we're blessed to have them on the show. So Marjorie Morrison from PsychArmor, mm-hmm. What a great organization to help folks that, I mean, everybody knows somebody that might need some help. And how do we best help them? We can jump on her website, psycharmor.org.
She dispelled a bunch of myths, too, about getting help afterwards as opposed to getting help ahead of time.
Yep.
Sort of setting yourself up. But she dispelled a lot of myths about veterans and that veterans are not broken. They're strong. They're employed at higher numbers than the rest of the population.
Yep. And all of them don't have PTSD.
No, we don't.
You know? And so even if they do, there's ways to accommodate them in the workplace. And it's all about education. And it's free. So psycharmor.org.
Speaking of the workplace, John Engstrom,
studly man that he is. He's a Mustang Marine and obviously very gifted at helping people transition. Got the SBA going, Boots to Business, and Business 101. And I think you also saw him in action.
Yeah, Marine Executive Association. I've been in that class. It changed my resume. It changed the way I wanted to present myself. As you were talking, I was ticking off all the things that John does well.
Yeah, he does everything well. And I think some of the mistakes that folks make when they're getting out is not networking. And he is the consummate networker. He's got 35,000 people that he's linked into on LinkedIn. So
speaking of telling stories, great. Not just your own stories, but other people's stories, we had two ladies from the GI Film Festival. Mm-hmm. We had Jodi Cilley from the Film Consortium. And we had Sara Vladic, who's a filmmaker. They both told some great stories and explained how stories create connection and family.
Yeah, exactly, and that's so important. And there's so many great connections here in San Diego, and we want to hear about more. So please let us know here on homefrontmedia.org. Let AJ and I know who you think we should have on our show next. So until next week, we'll see you later.